Hey guys.
Hey there.
Coffee with the Realtor Wednesday morning bright dream.
Thought I'd wake you up.
Life will pass me by if I don't open up my eyes.
Wait for a
couple
people to join us
today.
Come on, we're bored.
So wake me up when it's all over.
Let's go. We're going to talk real estate today. Negotiations. Who's out there in Facebook land? Somebody is.
Hey, Amanda.
Hey.
We're going to have some fun this morning, guys. We're going to talk all about negotiations. So negotiating new home sales, negotiating when you're putting an offer in on a property, different inspection points, all kinds of different stuff. So
expectations. What everybody needs.
Yeah.
Who else is out there? We're waiting for you. We're ready. Give you a little bit of music to go along with your day. Tuesday. Probably our Saturday, but it's all good. Wednesday.
Hey,
you know what?
The
beautiful thing about what today is that if we don't know what day it is, we must be doing something right. Runs right into the next day. Whew, Lord. Hey, water's not enough. Who's out there? We're waiting on you.
Wish that I could stay forever this young. Not afraid to close my eyes.
Talking about negotiations, what to do with the contract, it comes in, you're the seller or you're the buyer. We're going to talk all about that and how to get the winning edge on a contract, even in a good market. If you're competing, like we've seen some markets, I've seen it back in 04, those were the days. We've got six contracts coming in for the same property in the first hour. Rode that roller coaster ride. It was a high ride. And bids were going out the roof. And I don't know if some people out there have sustained that 2004 market yet. You know, I finally went over the edge, sold mine in December. Winning. But we just had to wait it through, so.
So those of you guys just joining us, we're going to be talking about negotiations today. So negotiating new home contracts, current home contracts, and all the home inspections that go along with it. Hey, Pam, so did you call me the other day? Love to talk to you when you're back. Haven't seen you. All right, let's talk about negotiations here. All right, negotiating contracts.
Yeah. So I'll let you start, and
Okay. We'll
talk about what we need to do and how we need to do it.
Yeah, so the kind of the first big negotiation that you're going to go through is you're going to be, especially if you're on the buyer side, you're going to be putting in a contract to home sellers.
Right.
So you're going to be working with your agent to write a contract, whether it's to new construction,
right,
to one of the awesome builders out there like Atlantic Builders, whether you are writing to an existing home, you're going to be submitting that offer. So if I'm the buyer, I'm going to be writing as good a contract as I possibly can with favorable terms, and I'm going to pass it over to the seller. And what's the seller going to do?
Yeah, I mean, the seller's got a couple of options. One is days on the market, right? So if the house has been on the market less than a day, whatever you're submitting, is that something that they're going to take?
Right.
Customarily in this area, we're at a 3% buyer's paid closing cost, so we kind of let the seller know that ahead of schedule.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they're okay with that, and sometimes they're not. So it's really all depends on what the other party wants. So if it's a good, clean contract, and meaning that maybe minimal cost off the sales price, minimal cost off the closing cost, and minimal inspections, which, I mean, you know, everybody should be doing inspections anyways, but
right,
if it's minimal and somebody really wants the house, then that may be the edge that takes it over. So in other words, you could come in at full price, 3% in closing, and, you know, home inspection, no rate on inspection, and the termite inspection the buyer will do. And sometimes that wins over another one that has just a simple termite inspection the seller's doing.
Right.
So that you're saving the seller $70, so they're saying, yeah, winning.
Okay.
But,
makes sense.
You know, the other portion to negotiating a contract is pre-qualification versus pre-approval. That's huge. Absolutely. That means you have put all your ducks on the table at the lender, mm-hmm. and the lender's saying, okay, you're good for this amount of money, and you're mm-hmm. pre-approved because I've seen your credit, I've seen your documentation, I know you have a job, right. and it sustains what we're trying to give you for money, right. and that gets you over the edge, and the only thing they're waiting on is you to identify the property, get an appraisal done, finish the title work to that property, mm-hmm. and get a clear closing and no other conditions that have to go along with that. Right. So that could be the leading edge.
Right.
Another leading edge could be a higher EMD, a deposit. Mm-hmm. Same strategy, 3% in closing, full price, home inspection, radon inspection, termite, right. and put a $10,000 deposit as opposed to what we're seeing typically as a $1,000 deposit.
Right, put some skin in the game.
Yeah, and so that just very simply means that if you decide you're going to buy the house across the street mm-hmm. and you default on the contract, the seller can take the $10,000, apply it to what they've lost, and keep moving.
Okay.
So those are some of the avenues.
So what would be the normal? So let's say I'm Mr. Buyer, or let's go Mrs. Buyer, obviously.
Yep.
And I put a contract in, and you're the seller, and you're like, I'm okay with some of these terms, but not the other ones. What does that process look like? What do you do? What am I going to see as the buyer?
Okay, so as the buyer, you're talking about what the seller may do. Is that just give expectations what the
yeah.
seller may do?
Yeah.
Well, the seller can always counter whatever right. you have in the contract.
Okay.
There's the option to do that. Because like around here, we have probably, I don't know, 25% people that have septic systems, right?
Sure.
And so the seller may counter it back and say, no, we're not paying for the septic clean right. out and inspections. You pay for that if you want the house. So they may strike that out, and if they strike that out, that means you have to initial before all parties okay. have accepted the contract. So the expectations on the buyer side is that the seller may or may not take your offer. Now, if it's something where the seller must move quickly, where we have some of that going on before, now, and after, we'll always
right.
have that, then they may consider your offer, and they may, if it's only been on a day, they may wait the weekend outright
sure.
To yeah. see what the weekend brings. That means you have the ability as the buyer to make changes to that contract to put it in
right.
stronger.
Right.
Because until all parties accept, you have the right to change it. You have
right.
the right to withdraw it.
Right.
The seller
both
has
sides.
The right to reject it.
Right.
So, I mean, everything is wide open when it comes to a non-ratified contract.
Wow. So basically, buyers, we can put an offer in. The seller can make changes. And it bounces back. It can go back and forth as
yes.
many times as necessary
right.
until both parties either agree
right.
or one says, I'm out of here. I'm popping
right.
smoke. This is enough. This is crazy.
Right.
So it's good to go in strong right off the bat. That's
right.
what I'm hearing Robin say here.
Yes.
And, you know, trying to make sure that you're putting yourself in a good position that seller is going to make minimal changes to your contract, minimal
right.
negotiations, right?
Right.
And all parties can sign off and then move to the next step, which is those inspections you were talking about.
Right. And I think a lot of buyers, what I'm seeing or what we're seeing in our contracts is that the biggest question of the day is, well, I have cash. All right.
right.
We've seen it at $300,000,
right.
$400,000 cash buying
right.
a house. How does that make it stronger? Can I come in $70,000 lower?
Right.
And at the end of the day, if you flip that around and put yourself in the seller's position,
right.
would you take it? And the answer is probably going to be no. If they're
right.
qualified for $400,000, sellers are willing to wait
right.
30 and 40 days for a higher payment, right?
Absolutely.
So they're not going to wait. They're not just going to just take your cash offer because it's a $70,000 lower cash offer.
Right.
And that's in this market. So we may see something different later on in another market, but right mm-hmm. now in this market, it's still what we're seeing. It's still a seller's market. Supply and demand is still low,
mm-hmm.
so we're still putting houses up and things are going out, and we want to make sure that you have the best leverage when it comes to negotiations
yeah.
on all sides.
Yeah.
And the expectations have to be set, because
yeah.
if not, then people really get their feelings hurt.
Yeah.
So it's kind
Absolutely.
Of important.
So Pam is asking, can you talk about a lender letter? Local lender versus a letter from an online. Also, difference between pre-qualification versus pre-approved. So backing up to that,
yep.
there are plenty of websites that you can get on. You can type in your information
yep.
and it'll go, bing,
yep.
you are pre-qualified. This
sure.
is wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And there's even some really reputable banks that a lot of us use, like Navy Federal and USAA, that also have these online portals
yep.
that just go, yeah, based on the information that you told me that we have not verified
sure.
in any way, we think you're pre-qualified. But then what's happening is oftentimes if a lender is not actually putting eyes on this, the lender is going back, you know, and saying, well, you know, now that we've had a chance to review your file, maybe you're still pre-qualified, but pre-qualified for way less than you originally thought. Or maybe you're not pre-qualified at all. We've seen that happen a couple times.
Yes.
So on the seller side, when a lender letter comes in, we like to see a local lender, somebody we can call, pick up the phone, text message, walk in their office. Those are nice things for you, the purchaser, as well, because then you always know what's going on. But yeah, and then the pre-approval is obviously a stronger approval, kind of like what Robin was talking about earlier. That's a true pre-approval, which means you have a much stronger closing time, but it means you've done your legwork up front. So you've given the lender your bank statements, your past tax history, you've given them all the documents they need to basically pre-put you through an underwriting process. We know several great lenders that are willing to do that process and make you a stronger buyer because you're then pre-approved. Somebody has looked at everything, like Robin was talking about, then you can sometimes close quicker, which might edge you ahead of the competition if you can close in closing 2 weeks versus four. So there's some really awesome reasons for everybody to get, for a buyer to get pre-approved. It helps both sides.
And we've seen some buyers go after some of the great houses that are out here, to include the ones that we have up for sale, and only to be disappointed in 3 weeks because somebody didn't run their credit in the back end. And didn't figure out that their debt-to-income ratios were too high. And that's just a letdown for everybody. So we want, you know, if you're going after a house, we want to make sure that if it's that house that you want to be in the neighborhood at, and you've been eyeing this for 5 years, let's get you in it, but get you in it strong. And
well, it's part of it being a good negotiator is coming to the table with your best possible option. If you're not getting pre-approved by a reputable lender who's local, who has actually put eyes on your file, then you're not being your best possible negotiator.
And they're going to want to see the cavity open. They're going to want to see everything. So if you think that, you know, you owe $6,000 behind in child support, that it's not going to show up, it will show up. So there's things that are just out there that may sting you, and you want to make sure that you're covered. And the best way to do that as a buyer is to just go in and be honest, because the lenders here have such great workarounds that they can probably, you know, depending on type of loan and the loan program. I mean, I just seen it. We're closing on a deal this week where a credit card was paid off. I mean, that's just the things that these lenders can do to get your debt to income ratios in a better position.
Or credit scores up a little bit.
Credit scores up may take another month and a half, but credit scores up. Is the seller willing to wait a month and a half and hold that contract out there? Well, we don't know. If your offer is strong, we may have to hold that contract for the next 45 days till everything is in a line, in alignment. But that's the lender for us to figure out as agents all the way around. So if you're teeter-tottering because you don't think, well, you'd be surprised what you do qualify for. People just don't realize what they could qualify for. And that tends to be our biggest question. We always revert back to the lender area because it's the hot topic. It's the big money ticket, right? So in order to be good in negotiations and put your best card forward, it starts with the lender. It starts with your contract and what you're going to put in. So those things do matter, and they're very important. And we've got some really great lenders that are out there that we partner up with.
Hey, Scott. Hey, Barry. Thanks for being on with us this morning. So, again, we have some great lenders that we partner with. You can dive in, pick their brains, because they're the experts. And they have some really cool tools that can say, okay, and they can kind of monkey around the numbers. Well, if you do this and you pay this card or you get rid of this debt, here's how it's going to affect your credit. And so it's pretty, really interesting tools that they have. So don't be afraid if you get, even if you get denied from one of those online pre-qualifications, let a lender take a deeper dive into it, because we've had several people close on houses this year who didn't think they could buy. And we have a young couple working with right now who was so ecstatic because several different lenders told them, No, don't bother. And we got them with the right lender, and that lender is like, yeah, you guys are good. We got a couple little things, but, you know, give it 2 months and you'll be buying your first home. And that's a really amazing thing.
Yeah, that's just the trick. I mean, I look every day in our office in our glorious window here, and we've got an apartment complex behind us, and every day I see cars going in and cars going out. So they're paying somebody's mortgage payment.
Right.
I love to own those apartments, but at the end of the day, you're not getting the write-off. They are. and you could be writing off a lot of stuff and still be within the budget of what you're paying back there in your apartment. We want to make sure that everybody succeeds. Yeah. And you know what, folks? We're seeing 5 and 5.5% interest. Now, mind you, that is not a deal breaker.
It's
actually
high.
A pretty good interest rate. Don't let people fool you. We have seen 18%. I'm not going to tell you how old I am, but we have seen 18% interest rates, and we thought they were good then. But this is a good time to buy, but get your cards together so that you're able to have the leverage to go in and beat anyone else out of that contract.
Yeah.
And that's what it comes down to.
So let's circle back around. Great question. Thanks, Pam, for that one. So let's circle back around to negotiation. Okay. So let's assume the contract's in place. The buyer is executing their whatever inspections they're doing. So it might be home inspection, radon, termite, could be a well water, and a septic. Those generally hit like the major categories. Sometimes people do other little inspections here or there depending on what they are, you know, needing to do to a home. But okay, so, you know, Mrs. Seller or Mrs. Buyer, I've done my inspections.
Right.
Now I have this list. I have this inspection report.
Okay.
And it's like 40 pages and there's so much.
You must be talking about mine.
Okay, so what are we going to do? What are we going to do with this 40-page document?
From the buyer's point of view,
yeah.
You want to fix the ones that are most important, right? Home inspections are there for a couple of purposes. I always tell people they're there for the major components. We want to make sure the house doesn't fall down if huff and puff and blow your house down comes flying through there.
Yeah.
Two, so the structure has to be important. The main components are going to be the HVAC.
Yeah.
They're going to be plumbing. They're going to be electrical. We don't want the house to burn down.
Right.
So those major components.
Roof
is important.
That's been a big one lately.
So those are the important products. Now, if a door handle goes into a wall, is that something that can be fixed by you, the buyer? Probably. If there's a handle that jiggles and it's loose, can that be fixed by buyer? Probably.
What if I just don't like the paint color, like the carpet? I don't like carpet. It's a personal preference.
Yeah, I think that, you know, for the most part, if you've leveraged in and you want the house, you're going to take the house exactly the way that you saw it. If you wanted it different, then I would have put it in at the beginning of the contract. And that way, nobody's feelings are hurt when the seller says no.
Right?
They're going to say, well, you saw it. You put a contract in on it. If you wanted it changed, you should have negotiated that. I could have taken the other offer.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. But, you know, it doesn't always hurt to ask, right?
Sure.
I mean, I'm not going to say no.
Right.
If that's what they want, we're just the messengers. We're going to guide you, but ultimately it's your say-so.
So where is the line, and this is obviously case by case, but where's the line between getting what you need fixed and offending the seller?
Yeah, okay, so the fine line on offending the seller and getting things fixed, that's a pretty good question because I think a lot of times, you know, it really all depends on, to me, and some of the things, some of the buyers that I've seen come through, to include our own buyers, if it's a high-end house and it's $750,000, then we're going to be looking for everything to be fixed.
Right.
This is a product that you're pushing out there that we're jumping through hoops, putting a lot of down payment because either, you know, VA loan limits, the FHA loan limits, whatever the case may be, we're going above and beyond trying to go after this house that has a neighborhood full of saturated $700,000 to $1 million homes,
right?
So we have a lot of homes. So in that essence, then we're going to probably not offend the seller. We're going to just put this whole thing down on the list and say, hey, we want all this fixed.
Right.
And graciously, the sellers are being very gracious about that. I've seen it where some things come in and they're kind of important, but things that other buyers can deal with. It's just, you know, my husband's an HVAC, my cousin's an electrician, my dad is a contractor, whatever the case may be. If you've got that leverage and it is something simple that you can fix, then maybe that's what you would want to do. But sellers offended are going to be when carpet colors, paint, maybe some caulking.
Cosmetically.
I mean, siding on a roof, siding on the side of a house that is coming off, well, that can indicate more things behind the scenes.
Right.
So I always like to have that evaluated and fixed. And I tell people that. Now, there may be somebody, my cousin's a siding person, don't worry about that, Robin. And great, then we'll move forward from that.
Yeah.
But to get the leverage, you have to make sure that you're going in as a reasonable person, right?
Right.
$200,000 house, it's old as is. You do a home inspection, you're coming back and saying, hey, I want all this stuff fixed. And we're going, hey, stop, put the stop sign up. We're not doing anything because it's as is, right?
Right.
So those are the things that we have to make sure we're walking that line with, and understanding that if we're buying something $100,000 lower than what the market value is,
right,
well, then you're probably not going to get the $6 or $60 in repairs done.
Yeah. Let's touch on that as is for a moment, because okay, you guys as buyers don't know that a home is as is necessarily.
Right, right.
So unless the description says as is, sold as is, you guys might not know. So it's really important.
Right.
Another reason to be working with a qualified agent.
Right.
You know, guiltless self-promoters here, because we can see on the MLS back end that if it's sold as is or not. And that's going to give you a big insight when you go into, again,
yeah,
being your best negotiator, having all the information, maybe doing a home inspection for informational purposes only,
yeah,
which gives you the power to do your inspection, but then it's a go or a no-go. There is no negotiation,
sure,
beyond that. But and we're seeing that a little bit.
Yeah, and I think that a lot of that can be predicated just by simply going in and looking at these houses as buyers and buyers' agents, and noting that there are issues that is a deal breaker.
Right.
If there are deal breaker issues now, they're going to be deal breaker issues later. They're
right,
not going to go away.
Right.
The seller is probably not going to deal with it a whole lot.
Right.
And if they do, it's going to be at minimal cost, because they're
sure,
probably on the edge of adding money to the table. And that's
right,
not what something that they're going to do. But at the buyer's advantage, you have that advantage of writing or not writing.
Right.
So it probably behooves you to get a good agent,
yep,
and get in there and take a look at these houses and know that, you know, I dealt with mold before and I'm not dealing with mold again, or
right,
or whatever the case may be. If you're out back and you're smelling septic, then that's a clear indicator that there's probably,
yeah,
something going
that's
on.
An issue.
Yeah, so you want to kind of get those ahead of schedule, and that's the best way to do,
yeah,
that. And then you're not wasting $300-$400,
right,
another $1,000 for a septic inspection.
Right.
And next thing you know,
that's
you're
expensive,
walking away. Yeah,
it
could be several $1,000 in inspections.
So Pam's asking, she's saying, sorry, I'm leaning forward, guys, there's a big glare from our beautiful window. Do you see more willingness from sellers to address items on the inspection report when the initial negotiated price is close to asking price? That's a great question.
Yeah, that is a perfect question, actually.
I think when a seller takes a strong contract, meaning
yeah,
they're at or very close to full price,
yeah,
maybe they're paying minimal, you know, 2% or something in closing costs,
right,
then yeah, I think the sellers are definitely expecting, and hopefully their agent has set them up for, hey, if you're getting everything you've asked for,
right,
you're going to have to probably give on the home inspection a little bit.
Yep.
Now, hopefully, again, their agent has set them up for success. So we haven't really talked about the seller being a strong negotiator,
mm-hmm,
but hopefully their agent has come through. So
yep,
what we do after we assign a new client is we come through and we do a staging consult, and
yep,
we go through the house with you top to bottom, and we go, fix this, move that, get rid
yep
of this.
Yep.
And we make sure the house is ready,
yep,
cleared for inspections. If we find things in advance, we get them repaired. That sets everybody up for success too, because
right,
then hopefully the seller is having to agree to less repairs on the back end.
Right.
And the house is showing better up front.
Yep.
You know, buyers feel more confident in that.
Yep.
So it's kind of a double-edged sword. Great question, Pam.
It just minimizes confrontation, right? That's
absolutely
what we all want to do. You know, it just seems like a lot of times we're fighting fires and battling, which that's
right,
exactly what we do. But we want to minimize confrontation as much as possible,
mm-hmm,
because right when things get heated and people decide to pull out of a contract over a $60, $70 repair, I'm totally amazed at that. I'm just utterly
right,
amazed at that somebody would pull out from a contract over a $70 repair,
right,
very simply on both sides, because it's going to cost you that much more to get to the next house when
right,
you could have just paid for that, or the seller could have
yeah
paid for that and got it finished and got it fixed. Now we're
right,
now we're facing making another mortgage payment.
Right.
It doesn't
right,
it doesn't equate. So
yeah,
we'll try to bring that back in as far as the seller representation.
Yeah.
But on the buyer's end of it, we may bring it back to your attention. Look, the house is sold as is.
Right.
You knew that going into it. You know, we said it clearly that we're not, you know, if you want it at $10,000 below the sales price,
right,
the house is sold as is.
Right.
Do your inspections, but we're not fixing anything.
Right.
Not that we know of anything that's wrong with the property, because I believe that's important for
right,
people to say what is wrong with the property,
yeah,
but it may be stuff that's minimal, like maybe a crack in a window that really, I mean, or we see a lot of seal failure in windows,
mm-hmm,
and that's where there's fog in the window. When you go to clean it, you can't clean it because
right,
it's the gas is gone from between the windows.
Mm-hmm.
That comes up often in a whole lot.
Right.
And those actually I've seen be deal breakers, because
right,
people don't want to replace windows that what, $300 a window,
right?
Glass, whatever the case may be. They don't have the time.
Absolutely.
30-day close. Nobody's going to get a window done or windows done in that time frame. So we have to be able to negotiate and come to a happy median. And that's really what we do. We're facilitators of the mastermind of coming to the table and making sure that all parties are happy.
Absolutely. And mm-hmm. a lot of the negotiations go on behind the scenes.
Yep.
So you as buyers or sellers might think, what is my agent doing? They're not doing anything.
Yeah.
That's because we're protecting you guys from it. We are protecting you from the stress, and we take all of that on for you. It reminds me a lot of like wedding planning.
I don't know anything about that.
My friend was a wedding planner, and she had this one wedding that like the cake was melting and falling literally off because it's an outdoor wedding, and they got buttercream and all these little things, right? I mean, the meals weren't correct. The vegetarian meals had been forgotten. Like, anything that could go
wrong. It's usually one thing goes wrong.
And
it's
the bride and groom had no idea. And that's kind of what an agent does for you, too, because that wedding planner was running around fixing everything, adjusting the schedule, moving the cake cutting up that they could adjust. And we're doing the same thing for you guys on the back end for both sides.
Yeah.
We're putting out the fires. We're taking on, bad stuff rolls downhill. Well, it stops with us.
Yeah.
And you guys hopefully are getting very little bit of that. Yeah. So you're just getting the happy end of the negotiation period. Yeah. You're getting, hey, guess what? Yay! The seller accepted your offer. You're not seeing all the communication between the agents that happened.
Yeah.
That was, maybe a little bit more nitpicky in between.
And I typically tell people, don't congratulate me until we're done. So when we're done, you can congratulate me, because then that means we're finished. But negotiations are wide open. So in other words, if you negotiate home repairs, the seller may come back, open up the closing costs that you asked for, and say, okay, well, instead of paying $10,000 in closing, I'll pay $8,000 in closing, and I'll fix it.
Yeah, right.
Right?
Yeah.
Wide open.
So Ollie's chiming in, as a seller, I had the appraiser add the major repairs like roof, paint, and appliances to get it appraised higher during the sale. Mm-hmm. And that's a great point. So sometimes, in a $400,000 plus house, if you don't have granite, we might recommend that you have granite for a very low cost, but the appraiser is then going to say, okay, great. This comp, these three comps have granite. This house has granite. Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you have a roof at the end of its life and all the comps have brand new shiny roofs, guess what? You might take a little bit of a hit, because the appraiser is able to, tweak numbers based on the interior upgrades and the finishes of that. They're not just strictly looking at square footage, number of bedroom, number of bath.
Yeah.
They have some leeway in there.
Yeah.
And so it's important to absolutely to, take into consideration or price appropriately, knowing that those big ticket items are going to come up. Because the last thing you want to do is be at the end of a sale and an appraiser says, I can't let this lender lend to you until the roof is fixed.
And a lot of times what we'll do as the seller's agent, because I've done a lot of that in my lifetime, is that we will price the house with those indicators already in the price tag. So you coming back at me telling me that it's going to cost me $15,000 to do a roof, we're going to say we priced it that way at the beginning. You came in below that. We're right where we need to be. So everybody can either move forward, or we break free from the bread table and we move on. So those are a lot of times what we'll do. We have to do that.
Yeah.
Because if we don't, then we're going to fail at the end, and we don't want to fail our people. And that's the last thing I want to do.
Well, it's all part of the negotiations.
It is.
So,
negotiations are like getting in, and it's rock 'em, sock 'em, cowboys. But the great thing is that we got a lot of great people in this area, from home inspectors to lenders to real estate agents. And matter of fact, there's some mighty fine real estate agents out there, period. I go to battle with them any day, and they're the best in the league. So get out there, get your game on, get out of the rental status, take a risk, move yourself into a higher dimension so you get those write-offs now, because we never know when they're going to leave.
Yeah, well, and take advantage, because the Fed notes from their most recent meeting said that they will be expecting a 25-point increase on September 26th, I believe, is their next big thing. It's, if you look at the poster two below us, we have the information on our page.
Yeah.
So 25 points is not 25%, so don't freak out. But, just be aware that those rates are going up. We're not expecting to see them go back down to the 3% that we've been at for so long.
Yeah, we tried to tell y'all, boom, we tried to tell you to get in the game at 3.5%.
We're not just crazy.
Because the market can't sustain what we're doing. So we have to be able to pay this stuff back.
Well, and we see gas prices going up. We see the economy stabilizing.
Thriving.
We're seeing some really
jobless rates are coming down. So with all that in mind, sellers are selling homes, buyers are buying homes, and it's a great time to get in the game either way. To represent you is the easy part for us. Because we do this all the time. So
some closing notes. We weren't here last week because we were up in D.C. We got to see Gary V talk, Tony Robbins, some other phenomenal speakers that just got us super pumped and motivated. But that meant we couldn't do a coffee card drawing. So we owe you guys a coffee card drawing.
Yep.
However, our amazing director of admin who kind of feeds us our lives, she's not here to tell us who won. So we're going to do a follow-up video later this morning, and we will let you guys know who won the coffee card for last week. And then stay tuned for next week, because we had a lot of awesome people chime in. So we're excited to do another drawing and get you guys caffeinated. So
So come back. Anybody has any questions, put it down there in the comments. Let's get it out there. Let's put it out there. Barry just chimed in. Barry's a great lender. If you guys have questions for Barry, get out there and talk with these lenders, because they're phenomenal. They'll get you where you need to be. And if you need a phenomenal lender, call me. I got one.
Awesome.
I got a couple.
Thanks, guys. We'll see you next week, 8:30 Wednesday.
Peace.
Bye.